I am a civil engineer. My specialty is transportation engineering, and my background is airport, highway, and traffic engineering projects. I am the first and only engineer in my family, and I've been practicing coming up on 33 years, and it has been a very good career. And I am licensed to practice in four states here in the U.S. As was mentioned, we are the first National Technical Professional Society, but more importantly, we're also a global organization. We have about 10% of our membership living outside the U.S. We have local groups that we call sections around the country. There's one here in the Washington, D.C. area called the National Capital Section, and that's where a lot of the local civil engineering professional society activities occur. More importantly for this group, we have 278 student chapters spread around the country in various civil engineering programs. You see on the bottom an agreement of cooperation. What that is that's an agreement that we have with an overseas sister organization. So for example, right now we are arranging a conference in about 2 months in Paris on automated people movers, and we are working with the National Engineering Society in France. We have been around since 1852. The picture in the top left is our original headquarters in New York City. That stern-looking guy on the right is the first president of ASCE, a guy by the name of James Laurie. You saw we had about 140,000 members currently. We started out with six. So, you know, that's where Mr. Laurie started. We were in New York City until 1997 or so. The building had five engineering societies in it. It was sold for demolition, sold for the price of $63 million because it was prime real estate in Midtown Manhattan. And a guy by the name of the Donald and some Korean investors bought the building to demolish it. And since then, they've reconstructed or constructed a 70-story residential high-rise on that, where the upper level apartments are in the millions of dollars. Oh, and you know, you saw the picture of the headquarters building, and our current president is Kathy Caldwell, and Kathy's a structural engineer from Tallahassee, Florida. There are three elements to ASCE's mission. Without value to our members, an organization like ASCE just doesn't even exist. But we have to give value to our partners, too. You heard Jeff mention a joint venture that ACEC, ASCE, and APWA are doing with regard to an infrastructure rating system. The society's roots are in technical issues, but on the other hand, we are heavily involved in policy discussions with government officials at all levels. We're also involved in the education of potential civil engineers, actually potential engineers, potential civil engineers, the civil engineering student, and the practicing professional. You know, we have programs to help people decide to go get the math and science courses they need to be able to go into engineering school. We have the programs to help an engineering student select civil engineering as their specialty. We have the program to encourage the student chapters to work with our student civil engineers, and then also the practicing professional. Civil engineering has been around for a long time. In the ancient world, that's interesting. Let's see if I can get rid of this. There we go. In the ancient world, civil engineers were really called the master builder. And in the ancient world, if there was a failure in a project, the master builder was killed. If there was a fatality in the project, the master builder's family was killed also. So now we've grown up a little bit, and now what we do is we call in the lawyers, and we just sue everybody. So, but, you know, it has been around. Civil engineer, the word was, or the phrase was coined in the 1700s by this guy, John Smeaton, who's an Englishman. The first engineering school in the United States was created in 1802. at a little place called the U.S. Military Academy at West Point. So ASCE and the Military Academy were able to both, the Military Academy celebrated its bicentennial the same year we celebrated 150 years of existence. Why civil engineering and transportation engineering is an important career field? It's because civil engineers, especially civils, impact everybody on a daily basis. Those of you that came in a school bus this morning, drove over a bridge, civil engineer designed that bridge. We design bridges, like you see in the corner, high rises like the Petronas Towers in Malaysia. We help communities plan. The picture in the middle with the big red circles on it, that's transit-oriented development. That's the Ballston area and the courthouse area over in Virginia, where transit and residential and commercial and retail are all in the same spot. So as the deputy secretary said, you don't have to use a car. Waterborne illnesses went down drastically when civil engineers figured out that chlorination of water reduces or kills waterborne bacteria. The other thing we started doing was treating sewage instead of just throwing it out the window into the nearest gutter on the closest street. You know, little problem with disease there. We're becoming more green. You heard earlier about changes in materials technology. In the lower corner of the set of pictures, that's a stormwater infiltration basin. The water comes off the parking lot, goes through a filter, goes back into the groundwater. Speaking of water, we take clean water for granted. You can't do that in other parts of the world. Last summer, I happened to be in China, and I stayed at a hotel that was built for the 2008 Summer Olympics, so it's not that old. Yet, I had to brush my teeth using bottled water because you wouldn't want to drink the water coming out of the faucets in the bathroom. So, you know, other areas of the world are behind us. Specifically, transportation engineering, we've got highways that can collect tolls electronically. The middle picture in the top, you really probably can't see it, but in the middle, there's a big sign up on the sign structure that has green on it. That's an electronic sign telling you what the road conditions are out ahead of you. If it's green, free flow, yellow, red is really bad congestion. That picture's from Shanghai. The bus on the top right is the MAX line in Las Vegas. That's a bus rapid transit or a BRT system. Civil engineers, transportation engineers, we designed the runways, the taxiways at the airports, and also the track structure that a train like the ICE in Germany can travel on at about 200 and something miles an hour. ASCE has 8 technical institutes that focus on the major specialty areas in civil engineering. My institute, the Transportation Development Institute, those two are linked because transportation planning and land development go together. Without one, you can't have the other. And our members can be involved in technical committees in all modes of transportation, rail, highway, aviation, that kind of thing, in addition to safety and security. We've got some other areas of civil engineering that are a little smaller. These are some of them. Forensic engineering, for example, is figuring out what went wrong. You know, you saw it in some of the videos from FRA, the crashes and things like that, you know, trying to figure out what happened in a crash. The other one is geomatics. That involves geographic information systems, land surveying, GPS, and a lot of other things. And just last week, our society board met, and we authorized, I believe it was 6 teams to go to Japan to look at the devastation from the earthquake and the tsunami, to learn from it, so we can help better protect the people and also the civil infrastructure. You heard about the report card. This is it. As you heard, C+ was the best grade. If I'm a teacher or if I'm a student, that's not really good. But more importantly, this is a great way to show what the condition of our infrastructure is. Everybody understands a report card. Congressmen like to use this thing. when they talk about infrastructure bills. The president has referred to it in addresses. We hold meetings with key legislators so that we can help them understand why transportation infrastructure is so important. The other big thing here is in 2009, just to maintain the system like it is, $2.2 trillion. You know, a lot of money. I talked about students earlier. We have 278 student chapters. It's a great way to learn leadership skills that you can use when you go out into practice. One of the ways you can get these skills is through contests, one of which is the concrete canoe. Yes, concrete can float. This one, the team designs and builds the boat. You have to do a technical design report. Yes, you have to paddle. But the technical report and the presentation are actually weighted more than getting out on the water and paddling. We've gone international. The boat on the right is from Laval University in Quebec. And the boat on the left is in the men's sprint. And that's Cal Poly San Luis Obispo, who was the national winner last year. This year is the 22nd year for the national competition. Concrete canoe's been around for a lot longer than that. But it was at regional events. I paddled when I was a senior in 1978. So that gives you an idea about how ancient the concrete canoe race is. But the thing, it's changed. We didn't have to write a report. We didn't have to give a technical presentation. We didn't have to swamp the canoe and hope that it floats, because if you swamped the canoe when I paddled, it was going to the bottom. But it's a great way to develop leadership skills. This is how I got my start in civil engineering practice, was being an officer in my student chapter. These are some of the transferable leadership skills that you can get by participating not only in the ASCE student chapter, but all the other major disciplines of engineering have student chapters on the university campus, and they all will give you these kind of leadership skills. The key is it all translates into the real world. The way that it's changed is when I started in practice, we did not use computers to design projects. In fact, when I started, I could design the pavement to support a 747, okay, about 1 million pounds of airplane, with what's called nomographs and a calculator. Did not need a computer. When the 777 came out, we had to use a computer for pavement design. The computers, when we first got them, you heard earlier, would fill a room like this. Yep, it would. And but you know, things have been getting smaller and smaller. Now, for example, my daughter is an architecture major at Montana State, and she carries the entire AutoCAD full design package on her laptop, so she can go to class with it. She has three-dimensional modeling packages in there, and it's all generated off of the laptop. You know, I've done projects on AutoCAD and the other design packages. I can run traffic analysis off of software, you know, things like that. So the world has changed. One other thing, just real fast on materials technology, you heard, you know, sustainability and things like that. One of the things that we're doing is we're taking old tires, grinding them up, throwing them into an asphalt mix. It gives the asphalt more stretch, and it keeps tires out of the landfill. So, you know, there are things that civil engineers and engineers in general are doing. So I hope you had a chance to see how civil engineering, more particularly transportation engineering, impacts your life every day. In my career, I've had great opportunity to work with great people on great projects, and the projects I've had the opportunity to work on have been a lot of fun. And I can tell you it's a really good feeling when you drive on a piece of highway, land on a runway, and you can say, I designed that.